Just going to move directly. Normally, we have another board member who does the introductions of the speaker, but I'm going to do it tonight because I've known Gary Sim for about 15 years, and Gary is sort of like me, except that he has more marketable skills. So he is he's an architectural technologist as well as being a very good artist and a writer. And Gary was born in Vancouver and, as he says, raised on a construction site, which gave him the kind of background of what he's doing. He loved to draw very much from the earliest times. And another thing about Gary, and you will see this with his work at the back, and I invite you, please, before you leave, to look at the work that he's brought at the back, and if you're interested, to purchase some of it. He's really an excellent printmaker, and where you see Gary out and in the community is often at events of the Alcuin Society, who are the rare book people. And Gary does printing demonstrations, as well as having his own work, and so that whole kind of rare book craft of printmaking thing is very, very much what he does. And just a final note before I invite Gary up, when we break at the end, please have a look at the back at the material that he's brought of some of his prints and his books. And so without any further ado, I'd like to call on Gary Sim.
Well, thank you very much, Michael, and thanks to the Vancouver Historical Society for re-inviting me to give this lecture. They asked me 4 years ago to speak 3 years ago, and I wasn't able to. But they asked me again, which was good because I'd done a lot of work 4 years ago for the lecture 3 years ago, and I got to dust that off and look at it again. In the meantime, they sort of made it clear that they wanted early Vancouver artists, not sort of BC artists, and early, not kind of, you know, later. So it was kind of hard to figure out, and I had sort of went back to the drawing boards and started over basically with a lot of new research. One quote that I like was a quote from Chekhov: "There's a high demand for artistry here, but God has not supplied the artists." He was talking about Siberia in 1890, but Vancouver in 1890 was just across the water, and it was pretty much the same situation. So I was having trouble deciding how to organize and present the whole display. So I got asked a Q&A, Madeline of the Historical Society, you know, how did I get into it? And that basically, to me, kind of untangled the web and sort of how I tell that story, just how did I get into it and what did I find, then the rest of it sort of falls into place. So a bit about me: what is an artist, early Vancouver references, groups and developments, and then a glimpse at post-1900. So we're mostly going to be back in 1885 to 1900. So how did I get into this? I bought this watercolor, this Maud Sherman watercolor, at an auction, an estate auction, and the auctioneer said that she'd been a student of Fred Varley's. It only cost me $25, but I grew to like it quite a bit, and I wanted to know, I mean, who she was, and had she been taught by Varley, and where was this? It looked coastal, it looked sort of tidal, but I had no idea where it was, so I started looking for Maud Sherman. So went on and got this, and finally sort of tracked it down to family members, went through the directories, found the Sherman family, found out where they lived, found their neighbors. The neighbors put me in touch with other older neighbors, and eventually I found my way up to Savory Island. And it turned out that that was Mays Point, or Green's Point, as it was formerly called, on Savory Island. And I, you know, stood there, photographed it, painted it, drew it, and it sort of walked in Maud's footsteps. Along the way, the Savory Island Heritage Society had contacted me. They'd received a draft of something I'd working on called Looking for Maud. It was a narrative nonfiction journal of my hunting for Maud and what I'd found and where I'd found it, and trying to keep track of all the information because I was finding a lot of information. So one of the things we found was the Sherman cottage on Savory Island. It was called Traumerei, which is German for reverie or dreaming. So they'd go up there and they just chill out. The Maud's father turned out to be an early developer for Savory Island, and was one of the earliest people to visit it and build on it. The house is now gone, but it looked like this in the 20s. Maud Sherman is sitting in the top left photo behind the table. And for a summer cabin, it's pretty well equipped with artwork and photos and maps and, you know, mounted game heads and sculptures and all kinds of things. It was quite an interesting place. And the Sierra Island Heritage Society also allowed me to access to a number of historical family photos that had come their way from Gladys Bloomfield, who'd been working on a book about Savory Island but was unable to finish it, and said, you can have all of this stuff if you finish my book. So they wrestled with that, because that was a major burden for them to take on. And they said yes. So part of the gift was a dozen boxes of original material. So top left we have Maud hunting bugs for her father in Stanley Park. Top center, costume in Savory Island 1918. Riding Prince, the horse that Jim Spilsbury talks about in his books, taking the water at Savory, playing with the cat. Her coming out photo from Artona Studios, 1919, and then Rex and me outside their house at Dundas Street. So I worked slowly, you know, trying to figure out the tree. And one of the problems was the Sherman family wasn't really the Sherman family, it was the Sherman family. Maud's father had changed his name from Sherman to Sherman for reasons still unknown, somewhere around 1890. So I was looking for Shermans when I should have been looking for Shermans. I phoned every Sherman in the phone book. You guys remember phone books, right? Couldn't find anybody because it was the wrong family. But I did find a sort of trait of family tree, and after 3 years of research, I'd sort of come up with this was the family tree. And of all of these people, I was able to interview 8 people, the ones sort of in these little green things down here, the lower generations. It was a heck of a lot of work, but it was a very interesting family. Here's a very truncated family tree. On the left, you have Maud's first cousin, Walter Noble Sage, who was a founding president of the Historical Society, through her mother, who had a number of brothers and sisters, including George Sage, or Archdeacon Sage. Maud's father was a provincial land surveyor, Vancouver pioneer, an old-timer, school teacher, artist, entomologist, photographer, climber, stamp collector, and on and on. His brothers were Vancouver's first and second weathermen, the two guys in the middle, Thomas Sherman and Stacy Sherman. And their descendants included Daryl Duke in the lower right corner and Dr. David Hardwick and Dr. Walter Hardwick, who are all very sort of prominent people in Vancouver history. So, none of them had the Sherman family name, but it was a very interesting exercise. And I interviewed Daryl Duke a number of times, and Walter Hardwick and David Hardwick, and they're all very, very interested in their family tree and what was in it and who they were. Some more photos. Maud and her mother, I started wanting to see a photo of Maud painting. So she's painting in Stanley Park before Cunningham rammed through the seawall, as you might say. I used to go down to the seawall and watch him working, because you'd ride your bike and it ended and this guy was chiseling stones and things. It was kind of neat to see. Then we have Maud's father, R.S., lower right, in the house at Dundas Street. And then a photo, 3 people having a picnic. That's Maud front, her niece June, and then Winifred Sherman in the white dress. And Winifred is Daryl Duke's mother. And then lower left, we have Maud's mother, Nellie, on Savory Island. So I found the original family home on 3642 Dundas Street. It was built by Maud's father. They completed it and moved in 1913. Josiah Wilson McCadden was noted as the architect of it. He was also an artist, and he built the same house next door. And apparently they had a friendly competition to see who could build the best house from the one design. I guess it was a fairly economical way of working too. So a cousin of Maud's, Joan Lindsay, gave me a number of family photos from inside the house, and these pictures were all attributed to Stuart Thompson. Now, Joan Dendis, who gave me a number of artworks, said that there was an Australian guy, he wasn't a very nice man, who boarded with them and took pictures. Well, eventually it turned out that it was Stuart Thompson, the historical photographer. He moved in with the family in 1940 and lived with them until he died in 1960. And during that time, June, Maud's niece, had become his assistant partner and then the owner when he died in 1960. And to my knowledge, threw everything out. that was left. Thompson had already donated quite a few thousand photographs to various places, but the last 20 years from 1940 to 1960, I think, were pretty much gone. Anyway, Mrs. Joan Dendy's was their neighbor down the lane. This was her house, and just up the lane to the left of the house was the Sherman House. It was built about 1905, and it's the only house I've ever been in that had a beaten earth floor, like a pounded earth floor. It just looked like wax, but it was kind of weird and wobbly. It was interesting to see. It'd been like walked on for 100 years. She insisted on giving me a whole collection of Maud Sherman artwork, because I was the only person she'd ever met who knew the family, and I was trying to refuse, and she looked at me and said, "Don't make me mad." I was like, "Okay, all right." So she gave me all the stuff, and I just started. It was a massive, there was like 80 to 100 artworks and pen and ink drawings. These were 18 pen and ink drawings that were done around 1920. A couple of framed watercolors, and on the left is a photo of one of the watercolors that I took in the same spot. That's the east end of Mace Point. We can't get there now. The guy who owns the Rocky Mountain here has built a fence across the island. And then there was a series of watercolors of, these are all 7x10. Excuse me. From places all over BC, and she traveled quite extensively, it turned out. And she was a founding student at the art school, the Vancouver School of Decorative and Applied Arts. And in the first annual, the Paint Box in 1926 had a full multi-page article titled Places to Sketch, in which she described all of the paintings basically that I had now in my collection. So she must have been just writing this article on. And then I went to Desolation Sound and Port Alberni, and it was really neat to sort of have that verification. A few years later, she had a studio at 1087 Butte Street, which was known as Paracontis, owned by Beatrice Lenny's grandfather, apparently, and other people who had studios there included Frederick Varley, Jock MacDonald, Maisie Robertson, Norma Park, and Maud Sherman. In this photo, Maud's holding court in the center at the top photo. They're all smoking. They all apparently chain smoked, and they're all butts and what do you think of this sketch? You know, and the drawing that's directly above Maud in the top photo is a pencil sketch of Savory Island that I now have. And I just found the picture in the archives of the same pair of trees on Savory Island titled The Lonely Pines, Savory Island, 1934. And I did, in the second year annual, find her writing an article about taking design class from Mr. Varley. So she was a student of Varley. She was his student in 26, 27, 27, 28, and 29, 30. Missed a year, and unfortunately, she never graduated. If she'd graduated, and she was a founding student, if she'd graduated, she would have been one of the first class. However, she didn't. However, she did do a lot of work for her father. Her father was writing books and stories for J.M. Denton Sons and also for School Days magazine, published by the school board in the 20s here. And a lot of these drawings were just quite fabulous. Like I love the one bottom center where a guy's feeding peanuts to dinosaurs standing on Kitt's Point. And in the background is the Sylvia Hotel in the Anglesey. And when I found this in School Days magazine, I was sitting in the archives, and I looked up the window, and there it was the Sylvia. I'm like, sort of like, I'm sitting on the spot that she drew this like 80 years ago. And top right, we have an alarmed swimmer with the English Bay Pier in the background. She also did a lot of small little greeting cards, maybe 3x5 or whatever. The one of Siwash Rock has a 1937 calendar on it where you'd peel off a month every month. And inside each one of these would have a microscopic little sort of postage stamp image, the one of the lion seen from Stanley Park in the lower left is actually can't be seen, but it's a nice idea, and it was in a Stanley Park card. And she did two or three of the Hotel Vancouver in different stages as well. My Sherman research started in 96. By 98, I had this much family tree done. And the family tree wasn't enough. I was like, I still had all this information, like piles of stuff and binders full of stuff. And I once talked to Peggy Imrady, and I said, well, what do you do? You know, I'm just, you know, I can't control it. She says, well, that's easy, it's no problem. I says, what? She says, well, you just buy more binders. It's like, thank you, that wasn't what I was looking for. But I wanted to do it as a digital, because So I decided to do it in HTML and write web pages. So I started with this format here, basically dividing into major categories: artists, exhibitions, organizations, clippings, references, and images, and then other sort of files that might come in that sort of help out with abbreviations or occasional papers and that sort of thing. When I started, I was only doing Vancouver artists and only artists who exhibited in Vancouver up to 1950. So I thought that would be 200, 300 or something. And as Cheryl knows, from all the months that I spent doing research in the Vancouver Art Gallery Library, I ended up with like 1,800. And that was way more than I thought. And I think, well, should I cut back? Should I not bother? Should I? I decided to just stick it out and keep going. So I'd get an exhibition catalog, transcribe it. The catalog, when transcribed, more or less matched what the original catalog looked like. Every artist who was in it got a web page. There's two links here for Maud Sherman, a couple of paintings. They go into her biography. Every artist who's in a show gets a biography, and the more shows they're in, the bigger their biography. So full names, vital statistics, groups the artist is in, a summary, and then a list of exhibitions and works in exhibitions. And here's the two at the top, Port Alberni Sunrise Unsavory. That was basically the start of her formal exhibition record. And all of those, eventually people were going, well, that's nice, but what about Tony Only? What about the photo conceptualists? What about Roy Arden? And, you know, it's like, well, Tony was in England until 1954, and, you know, photo conceptualists weren't born yet. So it worked out a way to sort of expand into post-1950 by just briefly doing a sort of a summary of those documents. So I'd take a catalog, make a link, transcribe it, just the artists listed and something about that document, and then each artist that was in that show would get a link on their index so you could find them or back and forth. And digital worked out because that's what my current printout looks like, and this is what the digital looks like. There's quite a difference, and it's a lot easier to distribute these and reissue them and reprint them. In fact, my printout isn't really current. I haven't done the artist index A to Z for a year and a half, so there's probably 50 or 60 more pages in that. But it, you know, does give you an idea of the actual volume of information. And I posted a whole bunch of this on the internet, on a website, british-columbia-artist.ca, as well as links from my own website. Just for the public good, just get it out there because you never know. I got a phone call from somebody in Calgary who said that he had something that he thought I wanted, and I had no idea who he was. So I got a hold of him, and he had come across the diary of Maud Rees Sherman that was given to her in 1907 for Christmas. And I didn't believe that he had it because I know that the family material had been collected ardently by a family member and then burned in a warehouse fire. So it was all gone as far as I know, so this was astounding. So he gave it to me. He just mailed it to me. 198 pages, 10 original photos, just a diary of 8 years of Maud's life, including family photos, her parents. Her mother starts by telling about the day she was born and the first few years she lived. It was like, are you kidding me? It was like, I was put into short clothes on February 3rd, 01, July 14th, 1901, paid my first visit to Vancouver. 1903, we moved to Vancouver and lived at 552 7th Avenue. So these are some of the photographs that were tipped into it. So Maud at about age 2, upper left, 5th in Canby, top center, 7th in Canby, lower left, and a number of pictures of Maud. The threesome in the middle is Maud and her mother and her brother, 2285 West 6th Avenue, before their house was built there. And that was before, long before they moved to Dundas Street. She had a personal timetable, what she would do every day: read, write, practice piano, intermission after supper. I'm not sure if that's going out for a smoke or, you know, do as you please, 9:15 till bedtime. Bedtime at 10? She's 9 years old. I just go to bed at like 8 when I was that old. And play outdoors, read when it is night, wet or cold. So like out of the blue, I have like an intimate look at this woman's lifestyle and what she did. And this is a little sketch she did. It's Kitts Point, or it's Kitsilano. So that's Arbutus going up from the water with a dugout canoe in the water. Their house, 2285 West 6th at the top of the hill. And it's recently being cleared by the CPR to make way for new lots. So it's like a little girl's vision of Kitsilano 100 years ago. It was quite neat. And in 1915, there's two dates. So the first drawing was 1908. 1915, she re-signed at the top. So the improvements in lettering, I think, was just sort of an exercise for her. Her diary had all kinds of amazing stuff, a list of 143 books in their family library, including many first editions. The day the streetcars started running on 4th Avenue, they got their first telephone, saw the performing horse King Pharaoh, the family bought pictures, her father developed and printed photographs. They traveled around on the steamships. She talks about the eruption of the volcano Nova Rupta in 1912, the largest eruption in the 20th century, but nobody seems to know about it, including me, until I read this. She witnessed an armed robbery on the streetcar. And sort of, so, what are we doing here? So again, looking for just something on the internet, I found a website by a gentleman in Victoria called Doing Our Bit, and he collects photographs of military, guys in uniforms and guys with rifles, etc., and researches them and then puts it on a blog and tells the story of these people. So he found, at an estate sale in Victoria a couple of years ago, a box of Sherman family photos that somebody was getting rid of. So I got a hold of him and told him, you know, the family tree and information, and he sent me a bunch of photos back. So here's the Sherman family, like 120 years ago, and that's Maud's father and mother leaning against the tree in the background, and her father's parents in the either side of them. And I think the gentleman lying down in front is Walter Henry Wilmot Hardwick, who was a ne'er-do-well from New York. He was cast out from his family because he wouldn't take the church as the firstborn son. A very wealthy real estate family, and he had to come north, and he came north and he met Aunt Jane, and they had some kids, and they had some kids, and ended up with Walter and David Hardwick and their children, and continuing to this day. He was like sporting. He was into cricket and cycling and that sort of thing. So some of the other pictures that Clifford sent me were Thanksgiving 1913, upper left, and that's Maud and Winifred on the bottom, their grandparents, two aunts and an uncle. Top center is Vancouver's first weatherman, Thomas Stinson Sherman, walking down the road, Granville, 1944, a few weeks before he died. Upper right is May Day, 2285 West 6th, 1912. And then here's a couple of pictures of the guys with rifles. That's Maud's cousin, Rui Sherman, in the Seaforth Highlanders uniform and in the Vancouver High School Rifle Corps uniform. And I suppose everybody knows that the Vancouver High School had a rifle corps and everybody went to school with a rifle in those days? No? No? Okay. They used to have a law, apparently, that you couldn't shoot rabbits from streetcars, and I never could figure out why, but I think that's why these guys are going to school. And say, there's one! I can get it! Dang, I missed. And talking to another relative, Jean Hardwick was the widow of Francis Hardwick. He had fabulous sort of compiled a volume of all of these letters and things that he'd written over the, collected over the life. This was a letter that his grandfather wrote. Reuter, which is Maud's father, took possession of his new residence yesterday, so he now dwells in his own castle. No one to dispute his title, to raise his rent, or to demand a rent, or give him notice to quit, which are possibilities in rented houses in these new countries. I love the way this guy writes. Yes, there's one there here. There are so many houses built on speculation to sell or rent, yet the supply is not greater than the demand for the clearing of new lots, and the western houses on them are seen in all direction. Apparently Grandpa Sherman was a Quaker and he attended the 1913 Paris peace talks trying to help prevent World War I. It didn't work. So me, born in Vancouver, over the hill down in Nazma Flats, sort of down 25th and McDonald area, born in St. Vincent's, I've always been into wheels. There's me in Camp Howdy, motorcycle. Grade school, that's me sort of third row back. Pretty much white kids, we'd have to say, at that time. And one of the parts of the history of Vancouver and art is racism and the Asiatic exclusion. So not very many early on Asians or First Nations people were exhibiting in any of the events that we were organizing, and it was just one of the things that happened in those days. My father designed and built single-family homes, and there's an area of Vancouver between 25th and 33rd that I call Simville, because there's 50 to 100 houses that he built in that area, and they're all, you know, quite familiar to me. Unfortunately, they're being knocked down and rebuilt with something else now. I got a camera and started photo documenting Vancouver, so here's my view of the famous Hastings Street and the Smiling Buddha Cabaret, and today. And then sort of went wandering the province up north in construction and on the railway, which is what I wrote my book about that's available at the back. Some of the pictures from there, and then the last 28 years in architecture, and this was a one project that I did out at YVR, building a 360 by 180 foot clear span hangar. You could park two 737s in it. Biggest doors I've ever done, 46 by 176 feet. And along the way, I like, as Michael mentioned, I like drawing and doing prints. So here's a few of my Vancouver scenes, most of which are pretty obvious, self-evident. A lot of harbor scenes, an old foundry out on Powell Street, lawn bowling in Stanley Park, etc. But the question sort of is, what is an artist? And we're visual artists, and we're talking performing artists. So this professionally trained artist works as an artist. Usually they're represented by a gallery, or in the early days of Vancouver, they would be perhaps a CPR artist who'd been paid to come out here and paint and, you know, market the railway for them. Professionally trained artists working as a teacher and painting on the side described most of the artists in Vancouver: Spencer Percival Judge, John Kyle, Charles Hepburn Scott, Percival Weston. We're all full-time professional teachers and full-time on the side painters, and all quite well known. Then you have partially trained artists working in any kind of employment and painting on the side, which is basically me. And an amateur artist or a Sunday painter just paints for the fun or it's a hobby, and sometimes they get their work into a show. And, you know, back then the categories of visual art were pretty much the same as they are now. You know, pastel, graphic arts, relief prints, etchings, sculpture, photography. Arts and crafts were more prominent back then. Pyrography, embroidery, or they call it art needlework. Wood carving or furniture design with wood carving. Panels. Stained glass was prominent, and china painting was very common. You buy blank china objects and paint them. And the reference material would be like local periodicals, so the Daily World, the Province, the Sun, they're still around, most of them. The Western Woman's Weekly, or the Ladies' Mirror, the Saturday Sunset. The South Vancouver Chinook, that was started by the Murray family of Ma Murray fame in Lillooet later on. She and her husband started the Chinook and then moved up to Lillooet, and she carried on and actually knew her up there. And then there's like boosterism magazines, so like BC Magazine, Man to Man, Opportunities, The Western Call, Westward Ho, you know, just trying to get you to give us some money or get out here, you know, buy something. So there's a lot of boosterism and hyping going on. Some of these were after the 1900s, but it was about the same thing. So a lot of my research was done looking through the city and provincial directories, Wrigley's and Henderson's combined later on. And then there was school board reports, normal school reports, exhibition catalogs, original material, correspondence, photographs, and interviews of people. So I did a lot of work on directories to find early artists. So looking in the directories under the category of business listings, artist, the first 3 years, nobody that Vancouver was here. Then Tom Hugh Huron Roberts advertised the first year, 1889, the second year, you can't see it from here, Henry Wall Suckling did the second year, joined him, then nobody advertised for 3 years. And so in the first 20 years, like only 8 different artists advertised as an artist. There were artists in town, but they weren't either here long enough to get listed and then have the book come out next year while they're still here. So out of all these artists, 60 of them, the 63 listed up to 1920, half of them only advertised once. Quarter of them advertised twice, and only 5 of them advertised a number of times. So it's the people, just artists came and went. They traveled through Vancouver to a large extent, which makes it really hard to find them. And at the bottom, if all these colored things fell to the bottom, that's how many total per year advertised. And like again, up till 1900, almost none, and then started slowly in the mid-1900s increasing. until just before World War One, ladies are advertising more than men were, and then World War One is that big trough in the middle there, and surprisingly, all the women quit advertising, and half the men. I thought all the men would go to war, but some of them stuck around. So it's kind of an interesting way to look at the number of artists who are working here. Not that many, not as many as you'd think. So some of the earliest ones were Henry Josiah de Forest, who was a Freemason, William Ferris, who was, I think, an accountant. Thomas Fripp came, he was from England, and his brother, Robert McKay Fripp, below in this slide, came from England along with their brother. Thomas listed himself as a farmer in Hatzik for the first few years. His brother was an architect, Robert, and the founding president of the Vancouver Art Association in 1900. Fripp is wearing his Vancouver 11 cricket uniform in 1890 in this photo, courtesy of the City Archives. Lachlan Alexander Hamilton was the land commissioner, was appointed by the CPR in Winnipeg, but he came out and did surveying, and he laid out the downtown area, and he was also a photographer. He didn't just take sort of documentary, he seemed to have a bent for scenic photography. And then what else would an artist do? Well, advertising and engraving, but this engraver, as most are, tend to be unknown, so it's hard to tell who might have done this. The City Archives, many years ago, I think J.S. Matthews, produced a number of greeting cards from some of the artworks in the collection, which I acquired a few of. And I thought, aha, here we are, here's Vancouver, and here's an early one, circa 1880 by Mrs. A.N. Richards, so maybe she's a Vancouver artist? Turns out that she's Miss Ellen Chaffee Chislett, Mrs. A.N. Richards, or the wife of the Lieutenant Governor, who was visiting town for Dominion Day. So, probably not a Vancouver artist at all, probably just visiting from Victoria. So, still looking. Okay, I found some photos were offered to me, or some pictures offered to me a few years ago by Edith Fanny Kirk. And here's an untitled one of Vancouver Harbor. The Galt Museum and Archives did a show a couple years ago, and Edith traveled through Vancouver a couple times, circa 1905, circa 1910. So this appears to be one from the earlier visit. Here's another one that I had, and this one's titled actually Vanished Vancouver. And turns out there's at least three known versions of this. The Galt Museum has one that's almost identical, and the National Gallery of Canada has one that's much bigger and much more detailed and much more obviously done as a finished work. But it was interesting that even 100 years later, there's still three known versions of the same painting out there. And you're able to compare. In the one I had, which was this one, you can't really tell where it is because you can't see any mountains in the distance. If there's a mountain, it's the harbor looking north. But in the National Gallery one, the mountains are there, so it's the harbor looking north, which kind of puts it maybe along the shoreline in Stanley Park, I'm not sure, or maybe down along the shoreline somewhere else. I'm not entirely sure. It's sort of fun trying to figure that one out. But here's the close-up of the signature, Vanished Vancouver, which is neat because also somebody else did the title of the same thing in the 20s, and then that sort of got resurrected again by our current president of the Historical Society. Of course, there's a number of early photographs, and just to give a quick view of what if an artist arriving in Vancouver would see, say this is just before the train, there wasn't much to see, right? Not many street lights and not much else. In fact, I think they hired a street lamper in 1888 and laid him off 3 months later because they put in electric lights. So that was the shortest held lamp lighting career in Vancouver. So the museum used to pump out a number of sort of little pamphlets that when they were sort of the museum/archives, and now they're sort of separate. So Vancouver before the train. So this was a typical view. If you're standing in downtown Granville or Howe Street, that's what you see, stumps and slash burning in the distance and a couple of ships at anchor. And here they are building the train station. You can see the grade coming in, and that's going to be the freight sheds out in the water. If you looked inland from there, here's what you'd see. Just a few big houses at the foot of Howe Street, and not much else, bare land. So here's the arrival of the first train, fairly commonly known photo. Highly decorated train. There's a ceremonial arch built over by the station, which would have occupied some artists, kept them busy. And then I came across this online, which is a view of the same thing. It looked like an engraving, but it didn't quite look like an engraving. And a couple of views. And it was from an album. It was called Views, British Columbia and Alaska, that was given by Una Langman to UBC recently. And they'd scanned the images and posted them on a web page, sort of one image per page. And I was looking at those, and I was zoomed in, and I was like, geez, you know, that just, what is that? It doesn't look like an engraving, because it's multi-tonal. It's got all these shades. It's not, it looks more like an etching, but or almost like an aquatint in terms of printmaking. It was quite interesting to see. So I looked online, and I found an actual real copy of it for sale at Murdoch's bookstore in Mission, and bought it for a reasonable price and had it in my hot little hands in a few days. So it's actually beautiful. It's about 5-6 inches high by 4 inches wide. It's published by Waite in Victoria, the most worshipful brother. He was again a Mason. Born in Boston, came to California, British Columbia in 1862. Got into publishing with a bird's eye view of Victoria, shown here, and then published the views circa 1889, 1890. It's not 100% certain. Had to be after the train arrived because he's shown the train station and the train, so it's post 1887. There's quite a few views in it, 64 views, so a guy could go through all of the views of historical BC and probably nail it down within a year or two based on where when a trestle was built or when a ship was around. It's called the Leporello album, and the Leporello is named after the servant in Don Giovanni, who was keeping track of his master's amorous conquests and kept having to add to the book to make it longer. This one, when it's fully unfolded, is 11 feet long, and it's glued together little pieces about this long, times five. It's actually quite fabulous. An amazing, amazing detail. This is like postcard size, and you can zoom in, and if you knew these people, you'd be able to recognize them. And they did a lot of vessels, including the steamship Beaver, shown before it sank over here. And the Stanley Park and the boiler came ashore over here, I believe. But it was still like, then I wanted to find out who did it, and I found out because once I got it, I could see the signature, lower right here, Louis Glaser of Leipzig. So in 1889, they sent this off to Germany to be printed. I'm like, not a BC artist, no, I don't think. There had to be a photographer who'd taken all of these views, but the artists were working in Germany. He was founded in 1866, 1868, employed up to 200 printers, and he produced at least a known 300 copies of this, versions of these view books. There's one from Texas I saw, it's 20 feet long, it just unfolds and unfolds and unfolds. And he invented the Glaser process for printing multi-stone lithographs, where he used 4 to 6 stones for every one of these little images, which we showed up here. Every one of them is printed with a number of stones, each one doing a different shade, starting with white and then going to lighter and darker and darker. So every one of those shades is a different print on each of these prints. So there's 64 prints, each which have been printed 5 or 6 times. It's an astounding amount of work, really. But not a local artist. I'd still like to know who the photographer was, because they're not listed. But I suspect it perhaps a San Francisco photographer, because he was there for the few years before that, so he would have known them. Still in early days here, I mean, Vancouver, geez, we're 1887. Vancouver just got founded. Cranky, let's go. So the first private art gallery, and that was really a major art gallery. It was the Hardiman Pioneer Art Gallery. Theophilus Richard Hardiman came to Vancouver around 1887 before the train and opened the Pioneer Art Gallery at 522 Cordova Street, straight across the street from the train station. And he showed the work of local artists and visiting artists and some work from abroad, but he included the work of Tom Huron Roberts, Thomas Moore Martin, who was a railway artist, William Ferris, Arthur Lee Rogers, and Henry Josiah De Forest. And he provided a studio space as well for artists to show in and for photographers to have a little studio in, which was quite neat. They were sort of like sharing their property. And the family lived upstairs. And if you went out the back door onto their had a little patio, it was just massive blackened stumps out the back and up the hill. It was like, look nice on this side, out the back, it's a jungle. And until 1901, they got into mining and closed the gallery. So this was the gallery looked like at the time. And his brother-in-law, I think, also That's not showing the whole picture. Why is that not showing my whole picture? Oh well, it started a music store as well, so it's the art and music gallery in this scene, which would be mid or early 1890s. And that's what the scene looks like today. I think they're going to be redoing that building shortly. There's a development sign up on it. So this was a little scene from his advertising in 1890, the Pioneer Art Gallery, 10,000 feet of molding to select from, and representative for the Art Union, which was sort of like an Irish sweepstakes for art. You'd buy a ticket and you'd have a chance to win a fabulous piece of art. It was like maybe from a major artist in England. It was kind of flaky, and like most lotteries, the government kind of cracked down on them, so you don't hear much about art unions anymore. One of the artists that they showed was Tom Hugh Urin Roberts, and he was an Ontario-born gentleman who came out here in 1885 with his family, and he was trained as a child by Otto Jacobi, who was a boarder in their house, which was kind of an interesting person to be taught by. And the family was apparently fairly well off. He was known to have bought a square mile of land out in West Vancouver, Caulfield, which is probably worth $1,000 a square foot these days. And he died in Vancouver in 1938, and he was the uncle of Charles Steele. We'll get to him shortly. So here's a watercolor that the Tom Hugh painted from their family house at Broadway in Quebec, looking down to False Creek, and on the right-hand side is the Westminster Bridge over what we now call Main Street. And basically, False Creek is now advanced two blocks to the left of this. One block would be on Ontario, Quebec, and then one over and Science World. So Science World is now, most of this is now gone, and everything, of course, east of Main Street and False Creek is now filled in as well. Photo of the same period from a block or two to the east. So you can again see the Westminster Bridge down sort of just barely in the right. And sort of pretty much is an exact view. So he was pretty accurate in his painting. Here's a photograph that the family private collection gave me access to. And I sort of zoomed in and twiddled it a bit. So he's working on some sketch with some triangles and a straight edge. Electric lamp in the back, it looks like. This is supposedly a scene of him talking to his father, painted by him. But my suspicion is that it's possibly by Otto Jacobi instead, drawing him talking to his father. He taught for before he moved out here in Toronto, he taught Timothy Eaton drawing, gave him drawing lessons at $1 per lesson, and Mr. Eaton paid cash, $1 per lesson, every lesson he got. And Tom, who was busy sketching him as much as he was sketching anybody else, and here's what Mr. Eaton looked like a little later in life. So I'd say again that Tom, who was pretty accurate with what he was drawing. And his name is a weird one, Tom Hugh, and everybody gets it wrong mainly as Tom Two, and that's mainly because J. Russell Harper got it that way, and he also said he was born in England, but he was born in Ontario, went to England as a baby, and then came back here. But I think the name Tom Hugh he's listed in the directories as Thomas Hugh, as is his father, Thomas Hugh. So I think they called him Tom Hugh to distinguish him from his father. It's kind of a contraction of the two names. That's the only thing that makes sense to me. So here's a painting that was sold at a show quite some time ago. It was in the catalog, black and white, Railway Bridge at the north end of False Creek. I believe this is the first one that they built, and we would be standing just sort of off to the far shore over there. This is Kitts Point, and that's the village that was removed around 1909, was it? In the recent lectures, they told us about that. But I think the federal government, the railway, removed this bridge because it blocked the navigable waters of False Creek. And I tried colorizing it just to see what difference it would make. It looks a little interesting. So there's lots of sketchbooks that Tom Hugh Urin Roberts left. And here's some sketches of Vancouver characters. This guy bottom left has probably got a goad, like for whipping oxes or horses or mules down the road. Some men at an auction. One guy looks like he's bidding. This is a couple of zooms in the details. Some other characters, and I believe the gentleman on the right is attributed to be Gassy Jack, but I couldn't remember that where I got that from. And then a typical sort of whole bunch of sketchbook pages. He practiced portraiture extensively, and also local scenes. There'd be quite a lot of information in those, but I haven't had full access to them yet. And he painted a portrait of Charles Frederick Hector Steele. This was the first white child born in Vancouver in August 1886 to Father William Butler Steele, a Winnipeg photographer, and Tom Hugh's sister, Mississippi Ann Roberts. So Tom Hugh Huron Roberts, Mississippi Ann Roberts, and his other sister was Erie. If they had more kids, they would have named every major body of water in eastern U.S. and Canada. They only missed a couple of Great Lakes and one river, right? So, and he was born at, noted as Burrard Inlet and North Arm, because Vancouver was so new, they didn't have a registry yet, so they registered in New Westminster, and they didn't know exactly where he was. So, yeah, Burrard Inlet, North Arm, over there, yep, fair enough. So that was very interesting. He continued being an artist. He didn't advertise much after the first few years. Just kind of quietly lived his life. Never exhibited. So I never found him in any of my exhibition records. And a lot of these artists never exhibited. They did something, and maybe the show wasn't to their liking, or the people that were in the show they didn't like. They just didn't show. An English artist, Edward Roper, came across Canada in 1891. He was in Vancouver in 1887. Still in the first year. The stranger entering Vancouver from the sea or by rail cannot but observe how narrow and steep is the ill-kept approach to the highest level. Everywhere else was a jumble, impossible to describe in words, of gigantic logs and stumps to match, broken trees and branches, all burnt as black as fire could make them. The business part of Vancouver was very curious, being also very new. Any sort of shelter that could in any way be turned to use for trading is. The streets were very crowded. It is worth remarking that when a pretty girl is a member of a party of travelers, it is a great advantage to her companions. When you have two attractive women, as we had, all are sure of great consideration. What he's talking about is like, when the train came in those days, it was like, whoa, it was an event. People would run down to the train station, all the local swains would be sort of hanging around going, let's see who gets off the train kind of thing. And, if an attractive woman, these guys come running over and, can I carry your bags? What hotel? I know where that is. Let me help you up there, missus. And then you're done. But everyone else being like, hey, where's the local swains? Can I get a ride or something? So, it's obviously a bit, out of date, but still, I thought it was funny. That's the railroad foreman in me. So moving on to 1889, finally a year or two down the road, Mrs. Richards, who first husband with Captain Webster, first manager of the Union Steamship Company here, played an active part in the earliest deliberations of this association, i.e. the Vancouver Art Association, founded in 1890. And prior to that, herself established a pioneer art school and organized monthly discussions in an unused part of her husband's office. It took me the longest time to even find out what that office was, 217 West Hastings, and I only found this portrait of Mrs. Richards this week, by accident, actually. So again, no real record of the art school or the art bazaar or the discussions, nothing that I've found so far that sort of says who was there and what they chatted about. It would be interesting to know. And the Union Steamship Company was founded in 1889 and provided access to the coast with a massive number of stops up the coast that you could get to. So Maud Sherman was able to go up the coast and get to Jervis Inlet just by walking down to the foot of Main Street and hopping on a boat. Like, to get to Jervis Inlet today, you'd have to charter a boat, charter a plane, or make a real effort to get there. It was funny, it was easier to get places than it is now. The 1890 Art Association exhibition catalog was astounding. It was the first real publication related to an art exhibition. It was about 40 pages. This cover alone uses about 20 different fonts. It was like, okay, let's do some drop caps, let's do some ornaments, let's do some sans serif, it was like, how many different, there's 15 different fonts in there. It's like pretty interesting that they would go to that effort. And page after page of events, and they had dances and soirees and conversaciones and things. So I transcribed this whole catalog because it was quite an interesting one. And so this is what it would look like. Everyone who's exhibited it as an artist somewhere has the hyperlinked name. Others were just sort of coming and going. And a number of sort of local artists whose names lingered on, for example, William Ferris, and But out of sort of what could be determined as to be the Vancouver artists in that show, only two of them, Lee Rogers and Will Ferris, actually really exhibited again that I can find. A vast number of people just exhibited once and then that was it. So where, what they did after that, I don't know. So the Art Association sort of fizzled out and then they started again in 1894. And a lot of this is sort of sinking in with booms and busts in the economy of the scale, and quite often it was foreign, like the bank panic in 1903 kind of thing that they referred to or whatever. So 1894 was kind of the doldrums in Vancouver, but they're trying again with an art society show. And again, the promenade concert and, you know, music and, you know, tableaus and entertainments to sort of get people out. But there's no other information that I could find on that one. And they faded off. They didn't quite fade off. They basically went from that and founded the Art Historical and Scientific Association of Vancouver. One other gallery that finally opened was the Art Emporium, founded 1897. And it existed for 120 years. It's still in business up on South Granville Street. Here's what it looked like in 1904. This is the corner of George and Hornby. I kind of cropped this in. This puddle in the foreground is where the art gallery is today. And I think it looks sort of like that in that corner right now because of the work they're doing. Out of view to the left is an empty lot where the hotel is for going to be, this lot for sale. Nothing there. And there's a whole block full of these carriages. And this carriage in the middle is from the Badminton Hotel. And that's one of the things that artists would do, would be to paint fancy work on these carriages. So you can see the little cartouche, a little diagram, little landscape scene in the middle of this. So that's one thing that artists would do. And I think they're all waiting because just one door down is Christ Church, later cathedral, but just then Christ Church. And there's probably Sunday. So all these guys are waiting for people to come out to church. And then they sort of get in their hacks and drive away. In a couple of places, you can just barely see Art Emporium just over the horses in front of the badminton. But so that was, it was neat to see that, and that's still in existence. Canadian Architect and Builder was a magazine from back east. Robert McKay Fripp, being an architect, became their Western correspondent and started sending out letters, BC letters, he called them, British Columbia letters, commenting there's no art gallery, museum, etc. You know, the Scientific Association enjoyed a successful season, membership numbers 51. Numerous additions to the collection, some specimens of Roman pavement. The financial statement shows a balance to the good of $77. Obviously not high rolling at this point. And they seem to appear to devote little attention to the arts. And that continued up until the 30s, actually, until they changed the name of their bulletin to Museum and Arts Notes in 1930. It was basically the museum. They were given occasional artworks and they hung them on the stairways and whatever, but they basically didn't concentrate on art. And owing to the lack of a public art gallery, Fripp is complaining away that we can't receive the benefit of, you know, painters and architects coming through. A Royal Canadian Academy in addition was forced to exhibit in a drugstore window among the toothbrushes and sponges. Like, this is not acceptable. But our city fathers appear to be too deeply immersed in acrimonious personal disputes or in the cares of ward politics to give much thought to such trifling matters as painting and poetry. But surely if the fair proportions of the citizens are really of a higher intellectual level than the squabbling ones who usually run the city hall in these parts, the deficiencies noted would be quickly remedied. And we are pleased to note that steps are being taken towards the formation of an art and craft society, and the chief efforts will be to put on an annual exhibition. So they put on two exhibitions that year. O'Brien Hall, at the corner of Hastings and Homer, was chosen for that show. Here's what the corner looks like recently in our fabulous winter weather, sort of a before and after. So the hall is the top part of the building with the curved windows up top, and it's quite a large hall. Windows down the side. So in this picture you can see light coming in from one of the side windows. So this is basically running along the length of Homer Street. And the works that they're on display. A lot of photography, a lot of crafts, a small amount of painting, small amount of sculpture. Some artists, or some photographers, had a large number of photographs listed. And very sort of homey, kind of, you know, well done. I think, you know, for 1900 it seems like a pretty interesting and attractive show. Don't know what the weather was like and how hot it was up there, if it was a summer. And then that was the member show, and the first annual show followed in September. And one of the interesting things here was that P.L. Okamura exhibited in this show, and he turned out to be Paul Lewis Okamura, or Sunanojo Okamura. Hi. I have a feeling they probably thought he was Irish, P.L. Okamura. Sure, come on in, you know. But he was definitely the first non-white person that I've recorded exhibiting in a show, and he showed a collection of photographs. Will Ferris contributed many pretty subjects, nearly always well chosen, but not so frequently pleasing in color. So Mr. Fripp actually takes the opportunity to trash pretty much everybody here. Mrs. Waterfalls were mostly very amateurish, and in many instances merely copies of no great promise. Oh, Miss Marstrand's second sketch is crude in color and harsh in treatment. Oh, dude. We regret to hear that Mrs. Belfer Kerr intends to devote herself entirely to painting in the future. Oh, I mean, he goes on after that because her, you know, her work in this other medium is so, you know, but I think by that time the damage was done, you know. Mr. Mower Martin was well represented, but the hard contrasts offered by the white snowtop mountains and the black green timber is scarcely true to nature. Well, Mr. Mower Martin didn't like that. Resignation of Mr. Mower Martin, read and discussed at great length. So here's a sort of a transcription of that. At a critical point, the president vacated the chair. Well, the president of the society was Fripp. So he's writing and trashing his own people, his own show. He's trashing the people of Vancouver who would buy things at the show, and he's trashing the government who's just hoping to support them. And then now they're sort of like, well, we're mad. Like, and he's like sort of, why are you mad? And it's like, because, you know, you trashed everybody. So the group kind of fizzled out. So they were selling tickets. So here's a ticket to the second show, 25 cents, admit one. And here's a ticket to the art union. So you'd buy a ticket like this, and the cost here was 50 cents. And then they would draw. And if your number 263 came up, then you would win an artwork. So it was an interesting idea, but there's a lot of room for a sort of skullduggery, you know, on the side of the organizers. What is, you know, the value of this, and, you know, is it given away, and where did the money go, and how much did we get, etc. So Mr. Fripp comments on that second show, held in the Fairfield Block. So little interest was taken in the show by the public that it was financially a complete failure. Such a collection remaining open to the public for 7 days, attracting an average attendance of 30 per diem, a nigger minstrel show would have drawn 500. Oh, you know. However, if one cannot congratulate the people of Vancouver on their powers of discernment in matters of taste, the officers of the association must feel that the want of success of the exhibition was certainly not due to any lack of energy or enthusiasm on their part. Dealing with a bunch of losers. And then the associators had some difficulty in maintaining the local character of the exhibition. Yes, nobody wants to get put in and have their work trashed, you know, across Canada. So we have made it to just after 1900. Elsewhere in Vancouver, Gabriola opened. They had a big party in July 1901. In fact, tonight they're having an open house to the architects are reviewing turning it into rental apartments and putting some condos in the far corner and retaining numerous of the heritage aspects. See how that goes. But it was an opportunity for the artists of Vancouver to do all kinds of artwork and crafts and painting and wood carving and sculpture and ornate material, you know, stained glass wood carving, the works. And of course the three graces on the landing light on the stairway up to the upstairs is quite well known. I had taken photos of it myself some years ago, but I couldn't find it, so I scanned this from the Three Graces, from the Rainbows in Our Walls that the museum published a number of years ago. The museum itself, with a grant from Carnegie, $50,000, cornerstone was laid in 1902, opened in 1904. For the museum, or the library rather, the museum had rooms upstairs, but they weren't able to get in because the contractor wouldn't build the last stairway until they got more money. So it's like being a construction administrator these days, I'd say that nothing really changes. And after the 1900, the population of Vancouver really took off as well. By 1910, there was 100,000 people. So people were arriving like crazy. The more people, the more opportunity for artists, and more artists arrived. Harry Hood, who bought the Art Emporium from the original owner, Spencer Percival Judge, who moved here with his sisters, Grace and May Percival Judge, and they were all artists. David Blair came from England by way of many years in New Zealand. Emily Carr, John Kyle came from Scotland, England in 1905. Emily Carr came to Vancouver in 1906 and by 1908 was advertising in the directories and then somewhat famously got snitty and went back to the island. W.P. Weston arrived in 1909 and he became a professional teacher. Statira Frame, teacher. Marega, sculptor, teacher. Margaret Wake, teacher. Charles Hepburn Scott, teacher. So teaching was what really a lot of these artists supported themselves on. There still wasn't really a critical mass of purchasers, although they were around. And new arts groups were formed as well, so the Studio Club, Society of Fine Arts, the Island Arts and Crafts Society on the island. The Hastings Exhibition, later the PNE, included art displays, although from the very beginning they were hung alongside of things like a display of stuffed deer heads, watercolors, stuffed animals, watercolors. And the Vancouver Sketch Club started in 1911. So all kinds of sort of groups were fomenting and starting to do things. So here's a picture of Emily Carr that was mentioned in one of the blogs about this. Charlie Hill sent me this. I don't know where it came from. She's up north on the Nass River and she's built this sort of outfit, you know, to cover her head and her hands and her legs so she wouldn't be ravaged by mosquitoes and black flies and deer flies and horse flies and chiggers and gnats and the other sort of carnivorous insects of the north. Rochefort and Danielle were a couple of ladies who came, I think, from England, but almost nothing is find-outable about them. This is the only thing I've found so far, from Westward Ho, 1907. In addition to teaching, Spencer Percival Judge did a ton of illustrations in magazines like Westward Ho and also the original covers for School Days magazine and covers of books for other people like this one. Grace Percival Judge did this book plate for Elizabeth Rogers, which I thought was sort of quite nice. Statira Frame was noted for her colorful work, a view of Cole Harbor. And the one on the right is titled Stanley Park, and most people go, oh, there's no houses in Stanley Park, but I think that's the south shore of Brockton Point. There were a number of houses built in that area, and the dock in the distance is probably the dock that you would barge over to Brockton Point to watch the bicycle races or the cricket matches. Now we just drive there. W.P. Weston was a studio artist in England, arrived here, and he's out on the voyage of the why not, roughing it and camping, and learning that it's a slightly different light over in B.C., but getting into it. And he was a teacher at the Normal School for the longest time, taught art to art teachers. So this is the Normal School, which is now City Square at 12th and Canby in its early days. And John Kyle was also a very important teacher there, and Deputy Department of Education in Victoria, and he long wanted an art school in Vancouver, and he actually wrote the check, $50,000 in 1925, saying, art school, here, open it. So finally, that was the guy who fomented it and made it happen. David Blair is very hard to track down. I haven't found a picture of him or his full biography, but he wrote a number of Blair's Canadian Drawing Series books, and he was also set some of the exam standards for education locally. Charles Marega, of course, arrived around 1910 and never left, and all kinds of his work is seen around Vancouver in different statues in different places. Charles Hepburn Scott, looking a little like a criminal here from the 1925 Vancouver School Board annual report, was the longtime director of the art school. I wasn't actually the founding director. George Lister Thornton Sharp was the director for the first semester, and then Scott took over in January 26, up until 1951. So for a quarter century plus a semester, he was the master of the art school and charted a good course for it, I think. And then one of the things I like to do is collect pictures of framing labels and sort of to help date when a picture might be painted, when it was framed, and the various iterations of these things. And they're kind of obscure too. The one upper left, J.Y. Miller, those were Bob McIntyre from the Burnaby Art Gallery sent me scans of those. They were used to paste down Samuel McClure watercolors into an old mat from the back. So J.Y. Miller was a framer. He'd sort of cut these framing tags up and then pasted this thing down. So we sort of scanned them and kind of played jigsaw until we sort of got enough of a picture to read his business card from 100 years ago. John Innes returned to Vancouver after many years away. He was here early as a surveyor and a worker on the railway, and then he left to go to the Boer War and became a correspondent for the Hearst Corporation for many years. Came back and did the Romance of British Columbia, which is like a 60 or 80 long series of drawings about the history of BC. Mary Ritter Hamilton, of course, was an early Vancouver artist who came from Ontario, and she was basically a war artist, a volunteer war artist. She went over to the World War, to France after World War I, and painted when she wasn't allowed to actually be there yet. Came back here, and this is her in her studio. She's just kind of behind that little chaise lounge there, which I think is quite a magnificent view of an artist and basically her career around her. Unfortunately, she died in Essendale of starvation, was what I gathered, so that was not happy. And thank you. Dedicated to the artists of Vancouver. No, it's Laurentia Herkmer.
Well, what was the question?
The question was whether it was Beatrice Lenny, is that right?
Yeah, the question was, is that Beatrice Lenny sculpting there? It's Laurentia Herkmer. She was a graduate of the art school in 1931. This was a picture that was given to me by her daughter, and she's also the same woman in the upper right corner sketching on Savory Island. The sculpture, she's down in San Francisco School of Art doing postgraduate sculpture work in that picture.
More questions? Anyway. Yes.
Are you still adding to your repertoire?
Yes. Am I still adding to this? Yes. I add to it continuously and somewhat needlessly. I don't know. I've been accused of being compulsive and obsessive and slightly neurotic about it, but I'm. As a construction administrator, I'm detail-oriented and I like to complete things. If you leave things out, then the contractor goes for an extra and the client's not happy, so.
But it's 20 years. 20 years since you began this?
20 years of research and 15 years of punching in the data, information into the project. Yes, Brenda?
The diary that you were given, are you keeping that or are you giving it to archive?
Good question. The Diary of Maud Rees Sherman. I still have it. I would like to find a home for it. I have, as soon as I got it, I photographed it from start to finish, and then I transcribed it entirely. And then I did a table of contents and an index and scanned a bunch of pages and emailed those files to a number of people so they would never be lost again, at least not for another 100 years. But I would just love to get it somewhere that it, needs to be, basically.
It looks fragile.
It's actually in really good condition. It's surprisingly, yeah, it's really well bound. There's a number of pages are missing, but they've been torn out or cut out. People have been taking out drawings or sketches or stories over the years. But for the last 100 years, it's just been out there somewhere, and then kaboom, it sort of lands. So I don't want it to go missing again, as it were, yeah. But I don't know who would most want it. The digital research project now.
Right till today.
More or less, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and including everything. I collect sort of every kind of ephemera, invitations, show cards, club cards, catalogs. People now are sort of very kindly collecting things on my behalf because they know that I'm looking for this sort of stuff. So stuff just kind of wanders my way. Other times I go looking for it, or people say, hey, I was at the show and I got this because I know you want it. Got $20? Well, I don't want it. Well, 20, okay. But yeah, it goes on continuously. They can't possibly do all of the artists in BC. I mean, 18,000 so far. There's supposed to be 25,000 active today. And of the 18, I've got maybe 5,000 or like from past. So I've only got half of today's artists. I mean, I'm not trying to do everybody. I'm still just trying to sort of finish off the early stage, but other stuff comes along that's so interesting. Well, that should be, someone else would want to know that. Oh, absolutely, yes. Yeah, oh, absolutely, greatly. But very much so more modern day, because in the old days they weren't exhibiting. They weren't asked to exhibit. There was no show that included them. And a lot of them had names you wouldn't even know was the First Nations, like George Cloutesy or Henry Dudeward. You know, they might be in the show, but you wouldn't know that they're First Nations. But now, significantly, I've got every time I see a show of spirit wrestlers or transformations or anything that's going on, I grab the catalog and make sure that those people are in there because they're finally able to be listed. I mean, there's a lot of prehistoric art shows, but it's like, here's a carved sculpture by unknown artist attributed to Simshin. Like, I can't really, this is sort of directed at specific people, finding specific artists, and it's hard to do prehistoric artists.
isn't that the sort of the gap between art and anthropology, and it's always been that issue about First Nations artists getting into the Vancouver Art Gallery as opposed to getting into the Museum of Anthropology?
Yeah. Well, and also a lot of their original material, it wasn't art. They weren't doing it as art. It was their life. It was how they lived, mm-hmm. right? It was the spirits. It was all part of their this whole mythos of their life. So they weren't, 200 years ago, they weren't necessarily doing tourist screen prints or, something that they might do today.
Yes.
Gary, thanks for that. I just asked a question about what you may have learned about why people painted. And I'm thinking of, from my own work there in early Vancouver, there certainly was a status-oriented quality about art and culture. And I'm wondering if a number of those people who may have maybe appear once and then disappear, is that they were really doing it part of their cultural definition of a place of being genteel within society, for example?
Well, that's a question that's been raised a sort of fair bit recently by Mona Fertig in her Unheralded Artist series. It's like the shunning of artists or the social sort of like the group, the in-crowd, the out-crowd. In early days of Vancouver, I think there was like miners and loggers and guys on the railway and, guys who were working on the ships and whatever. And there weren't too many people that were buying art. There was an upper class moving in, but they were the CPR businessmen and the merchants, I guess, were sort of the class then. We didn't really have the luxury for an upper class as such, I don't think, until the population got bigger.
Yeah, I just wondered to what extent they were painting for themselves rather than painting for a market. Because the people like H.O. Bell Irving, for example, and Harry Abbott, and the CPR artists, to some extent they were doing it for the CPR, but they also, they painted, particularly the women in those families.
Yes,
that was a genteel thing to do.
Yes, a lot of people did it, and it was very common. Women were like expected to be painting. If they were out and about on their own, oh, she's painting, that's okay. But if she's just walking around, well, it's like, what is she doing? So there was kind of a sort of a thing, but a lot of people did paint just because they wanted to paint, and watercolors are easy. You have a little piece of pad and you get some water and it can last for hundreds of years. Easy. Oil painting is more difficult, especially in the field. And there weren't art stores, there weren't places to buy materials, so artists kind of had to have what they were going to use when they came here, otherwise they're just kind of going to run out. So it wouldn't have been easy, and I think, they used to sort of go to storefronts or hotels. If you're staying in a hotel, you'd ask the hotel manager, can I put my work up in your lobby? That was kind of common,
But it is that idea of you somehow you survive and then you continue to be creative. Because sort of for you, and I know for me, that being an artist is like having a really bad itch. Like you just gotta scratch it all the time. It's not like something you can just say, well, I'm not really an artist today. You kind of wake up in the morning and you want to do things. It is the cross we bear.
No, the Super Bowl's on. I'm not doing anything today.
yes. When did art supplies start to become available locally? Somebody in school or coming out of school could have to go to Seattle or something. Was there a pioneer art supply business?
There was a few sort of photography stores would sell supplies and would also have studios that amateur photographers could use to develop and print their own photos. And they sort of also had kind of things on the side. You'd sort of seen advertisement and paper and, you know, supplies. But again, there were so few artists that there wasn't much of a market, so they're you know, scarcer than hen's teeth, I would say. I'm sure school supplies were probably ordered in bulk from Victoria, you know, to a large extent.